Good morning, everybody. Let's all stand if you're able, and we're going to sing number, I had the bulletin up here. What did I do with it? Anyway, number 191, I believe, number 191, There Is Power in the Blood. 191.
Would you be free from your burden of sin? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be free from your passion and pride? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Come for a cleansing to Calvary's side. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be whiter, so whiter than snow? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Sin stains were lost in the life-giving flow. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb.
Okay, before we sing that last verse, I was about to skip the third verse because I'm not really big on singing all the verses, and that Sarah is, and I think some of the guys are. Like, they're like, Pastor Craig, we got to sing all the verses. And you like all of them? So I like it that way, but when I put together like a worship service, I try and make sure we don't lose the gospel because I skipped one of those verses. But I was about to skip number three. But then I was thinking, as I'm singing that song, this is a different song, I think. Like, if an unbeliever would come in and they would hear this song, they'd probably go, what are they singing about blood for? Now, as believers, we know about the blood of Jesus. The precious blood of Jesus is an amazing thing. And it takes on new meaning for us. And the concept of blood and how Christ shed his blood at the cross and how important that is in the gospel, right? But an unbeliever might come in and go, wow. But then, like the third verse, I think that's a really beautiful concept. Because of the blood, we are made whiter than snow. And isn't that like an awesome picture, though? To me, that's, and I couldn't skip it. I was about to, but I just could not skip number three. So when we get to the end, I'm going to do something my dad used to do. If you want to sing along, we're going to sing power. We're going to give more powers in the blood in the chorus that you can even believe. So that's, my dad used to do that. So on the fourth verse, would you do service? Here we go.
Would you do service for Jesus your King? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you live daily his praises to sing? There's wonderful power in,
get ready.
There is power, 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 wonder working power in the blood,
get ready,
of the Lamb. There is power, 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 wonder working power in the precious blood of the Lamb.
All right, great. Let's pray together. Dear Lord Jesus, we are so thankful for the blood of Jesus Christ. It is a difficult symbol, not really a symbol, but a difficult concept that I think for people to understand that don't know Jesus. But it's a wonderful thing because it is part of the gospel. There's been some people that would kind of minimize it and say, well, it doesn't matter. Just all you need is the death of Christ. But the blood is a part of that. And the shedding of blood is a big symbol when you go to the Old Testament and the Old Testament sacrifices, which we don't have to do anymore. But we look back and we can be blessed by and we can be encouraged by as it helps us to point towards Jesus, who is the ultimate sacrifice and the ultimate person that shed blood, because he did it for our sins. And we give praise and glory and honor to you, because you are the one who has done this in our lives. And Lord, we are so thankful. We are so thankful for the gospel message. It is a life-changing message, Lord. And you are so true. Today we recognize you, that you are the one true God. You're the true God of Israel, of the Old Testament. You're the true God of the apostles in the book of Acts, as we just went over that book and read about the amazing things they did. And you are the God, and you are the God, Jesus, that did the miracles in the Gospels. Lord, what a beautiful Bible we have in the depiction that it makes of Jesus and the redemption that we can have in Christ. It's real. We know you're real. We know there's only one God. You are the one God, and we give praise to you today. Help us as we continue to worship you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, and you may be seated. Let's continue. I got to go get myself. Okay, the next song is number 186. Next song is number 186. It is The Old Rugged Cross. We're going to do the second verse without the chorus, then the third verse. Okay, Sarah? Here we go, on the second verse.
Oh, that old rugged cross, so despised by the world, has a wondrous attraction for me. For the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear. Dark Calvary.
Now the third verse.
In the old rugged cross, stained with blood so divine, a wondrous beauty I see. For 'twas on that old cross Jesus suffered and died, to pardon and sanctify me. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. To the old rugged cross I will ever be true, its shame and reproach gladly bear. When hills call me someday to my home, where is glory forever I'll share, so I'll cherish the old rose. trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown.
All right, thanks, Sarah. All right, so glad to have those of you who could make it today. We got some people out of town, kind of missing a few people, but that's okay. It is Father's Day, so congratulations. It looks like we have two other fathers here, so congratulations to you. And we're glad that you're here today. And we've got some fathers hopefully listening back home. We want to congratulate them as well. This is my kind of clip art that I put in the bulletin. Option be there for Father's Day. So I guess you should be there for Father's Day, and you should be there for your children. In fact, that reminds me, Dr. James Dobson, you guys are familiar with him and Focus on the Family, and he gives this wonderful illustration. You know, his dad was a preacher. He was a preacher in the Nazarene Church, and he, on his deathbed, like, can you imagine this? He's on his deathbed, and, you know, he's a believer. He knows Jesus, spent his life preaching the gospel to people, and people, many people saved under this man's ministry. He's from Texas. Dr. Dobson went to visit him, and as he's talking to him, the last words that he said to his son was, be there. Like, be there. Like, be in heaven with me. Now, I'm sure, like, Dr. Dobson has a, you know, he believes in Jesus. I've heard his testimony many times how he was saved. I'm sure he's going to be there, but even his last wish was, man, like, if you're playing a game right now, don't do it anymore. Be there. I want to see you in heaven. I have that confidence. You can see a picture of my dad back there. He was such a great guy. I wish you guys had, Brother Don knew my dad. He was always busy about the Lord's business, always busy about the church's business. Like, he was up here at the church all the time. There's a lot of broken stuff around here. My dad, that light would not be out if my dad were here. I'm working on that, by the way. And there's another light back. I've got an electrician coming, but electricians are, you know, slow to come. But he was always, like, doing stuff. My dad, like, he worked really hard jobs that you would think a pastor shouldn't have to work. He worked out at the Lake Mojave Resort when he was kind of between churches. And even during when this church started, because they didn't have a large salary to pay him, and he used to like be on the dock and, you know, pump gas. You know, I think that's a low job for a pastor. But my dad, there was no job that was low for him. Like, if it was a job needed done, he was there. He was there. So he was such a good example. Probably more of anything else, his example in prayer was probably number one. His example, because he prayed, he had this prayer list that I always knew he prayed for every single day. You'd go over to his house, and in the office on the computer, there's this long list that he had, like posted up next to the computer. And so he would pray, and I always saw my name on there, so I was always glad that, you know. And my kids' names were on there, and it was amazing. He was a man of prayer, but he was also, his hard work, his ethic was just powerful, always working on it. So anyway, congratulations.
Thank you.
Let's see. I guess I'll deliver them today. So, trying to think of what I could get our fathers for today, and I went to Home Depot thinking, what's a nice cool gadget I could get the fathers? And and one guy goes, no, with pandemic, we don't get those little cool little gadgets anymore. Nobody, they're not making those. They're the bottom of the list for the Chinese to make, you know. Like, oh yeah, I get your point. But then I went to Dollar Tree, and I found some of them. Check out this one. This is a screwdriver, but it's got all the different types of heads. Plus, it's got, you can use it as a like kind of like a wrench as well. And it's all inside of the thing. And then I saw this thing, magnetic pickup tool. You know, like, we have the no man's everything. My credit card fell between the console and my seat. Like, if you ever lose anything, that's where it ends up being with me. So here's your, I didn't get you, I probably should have gotten you a ribbon to tie around it, but that's not very macho. So we'll just hand these out. Here we go. I'm going to do this. Here you go, my friend. Chris, father to three kids. And Don, you have three?
I got three kids.
Three kids. How many grandkids?
I got four grandkids, and I got two great-great-grandkids.
Wow. Third one. Whoa. Okay, so you got a long list. And he's got a long list, I'm sure. He's thinking about those. So congratulations, fathers. In today's world, it concerns me because I feel like I'm not going to say the women's movement because there's plenty of good things that come out of the women's movement, but the extreme women's movement, I think, takes away from the role of fathers. And it's such an important one. And I think it's really important that a child is raised with their mom and dad if they can be. And whether you were raised that way or you're looking forward to that, I think that's something that we could all strive for. I think our young girls should be striving to find a strong man you can raise children together. A man should be looking for a strong woman to raise children together, to populate and make a difference here in this world, because there's other ways of thinking that aren't biblical. So anyway, so congratulations, Father's Day. All right. Let's take a look at the rest of the bulletin. Let's see what else we have here. Oh, wait, leave it there, Hannah. I'm going to go back down. What am I doing? I'm going to go back down. What's happening this week? Wednesday, we'll have our Bible study. I will be at Ironwood, so I'll make sure I'm going to have to get out of the meeting, and we'll have our Facebook meeting. I might even be at my mom's that day. I'll see on Wednesday. Maybe I'll go out to mom's for the meeting for Wednesday night. I'm going to be at Ironwood Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. Pray for us as we take the three kids that are going: Haley Dell, James Brown, and Kennedy Brown. So Haley, James, and Kennedy, we had a garage sale. We detailed a couple of cars yesterday. They raised almost all of the money that they need for camp. And so we're excited about sending them out to camp. So I'm going to be there Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. Looks like Connor and maybe Hannah's going to go pick them up at the end of the weekend. So pray that God would work in their lives and they would grow in Christ while they're there. And so that's all happening this week. So if you'll pray for them, and if you have a chance, you can send them an email or send them a note. If you write them, you got to write them before, I would say, got to get an email Tuesday morning if it's really for sure going to get there on, say, Thursday. If you send it on Wednesday, it probably will get there Friday. It's possible they'll get it, but maybe not. So it's kind of Tuesday's the best time to get it in. And then I've been telling you about the apologetics moment. So let me take a moment and review with you the cosmological design, moral, and New Testament arguments, resurrection arguments, and against religious pluralism. Those are the six most important arguments that we should be able to share with atheists. With the young people, we discussed the cosmological argument I played them the podcast of all of these things. We were able to listen to it, had some good discussion about it. Over on the left side, I gave it in a little more detail. Everything that begins to exist has a cause. The universe began to exist, therefore the universe has a cause. And if you have one of those cards, you can pull that out and use it as a guide as you share it with people. Because people want to know, I believe people want to know God. If there's a God, don't you want to know it? So if there is a God, if you can prove to them that there is a God, you'd think they'd want to know who that person, you know, that God is. Because he's the creator and the maker of heaven and hell. That's also important. So I challenge you to share this week. Try and remember that cosmological argument that there's something must come from something. And that's God. He's the designer. So that's my challenge for you. Okay. Let's do the next song. Let's take the offer. All right, let's pray and ask God's blessing. Heavenly Father, we're thankful for the opportunity to give. Lord, help us to be faithful in being a part of the ministry. One way we can do that is being involved in the ministry of a local church through the giving that we can. And I pray you challenge us, wherever we are, whatever our situation financially is, that we would do the best that we can. We pray this in Christ's name.
Yeah, I looked over and you were.
Yeah.
I'll get mine next week. I'm going to put in money that I. Okay. Okay, now we're back to the podium. Okay, we're going to do My Jesus Fair. And if Sarah. Thank you. Okay, so this week I was working on my message yesterday. I was thinking about, it is Father's Day, and I'd already put my message together, and sometimes I think about that a lot, sometimes I don't think enough about it. But anyway, as I was considering it, I was thinking, oh man, you know, like we are, let me see if I even have it here. Hold on. Okay, it's not even here. Let's see. There it is. Yeah. So as I was thinking about it, I was wondering, I should have done a Father's Day message. Then I thought, what I'm preaching about today is all about the great father of the world. Because we're talking about Adam here. So he's everybody's great, 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 great grandfather. We are all related to the first man. So we are going to take a look at Adam today and his creation and the creation of Eve and look at what that means and why it's important to understand it well and understand from the scripture. And who is this ultimate father that we're talking about? So that's chapter 2 of Genesis. So let's open that up here. Now today I'm going to have this up, but I'm also going to go back and forth from the, let me open that up as well. I'm going to have the scripture, we'll refer back to the text of the scripture. I'll have that open. Like I said, I'm going to try and get away from this, hopefully, more so as we go along. From using the PowerPoints, I kind of want to get away from that just a little bit, just because, maybe just for a change. So we are in part 4. This is my 4th message on Genesis. I think it might be my 3rd, but we'll take a look at Adam today, the ultimate father, the first person in the world. Let's take a look, and let's start off by looking at Genesis chapter 2. Verses 4, I'll open my Bible here and follow along in the English Standard Version, Genesis chapter 2, verse 4. And I'd like to just read through, that'd be good for us. I'm going to just read through the entire text here. So let me bring that up again. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished. This is chapter 2 of Genesis, and all the host of them. And on the 7th day, God finished his work. Make that a little bit smaller. God finished his work that he had done. And he rested on the 7th day from all his work that he had done. So God blessed the 7th day and made it holy. So we have the day of rest. Because on it, God rested from all his work that he had done in creation. These are the generations of the heavens and the earth when they were created. In the day that the Lord God made the earth and the heavens, when no bush of the field was yet in the land, and no small plant of the field had yet sprung up. For the Lord God had not caused it to rain on the land, and there was no man to work the ground. And a mist was going up from the land and was watering the whole face of the ground. Then the Lord God formed the man of dust from the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living creature. And the Lord God planted a garden in Eden in the east, and there he put the man whom he had formed. And out of the ground of the Lord God made to spring up every tree that is pleasant to the sight and good for food. The tree of life was in the midst of the garden, and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. A river flowed out of Eden to water the garden, and there it divided and became 4 rivers. The name of the first is the Pishon. It is the one that flowed around the whole land of Havilah, and there is gold. And the gold of that land is good. Bdellium and onyx stone are there. The name of the second river is the Gihon. It is the one that flowed around the whole land of Cush. And the name of the third river is the Tigris. It flows east of Assyria. And the fourth river is the Euphrates. The Lord took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and keep it. And the Lord commanded the man, saying, you may surely eat of every tree of the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. For in that day that you eat it, you shall surely die. The Lord God said, it is not good that a man should be alone. I will make him a helper fit for him. Now out of the ground the Lord God had formed every beast of the field and every bird of the heavens, brought them to the man to see what he would call them. Whatever the man called every living creature, that was its name. The man gave names to all livestock and to the birds of the heavens and to every beast of the field. But for Adam, there was not found a helper fit for him. So the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon him. And while he slept, took one of his ribs and closed up his place with flesh. And the rib that the Lord God had taken from the man, he made into a woman and brought her to the man. Then the man said, This at last is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. Therefore a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. And the man and the wife were both naked and were not ashamed. So that's chapter 2. May God bless the reading of his word. So let's take a look at our notes for today. So it's the ultimate father, Adam. Let's take a Genesis 2, you have to understand, is a flashback. And you say, well, why is that? Because we hear about the creation of Adam in chapter 1, but then we hear more detail about it. So in a sense, we hear about it in chapter 1, God rests, and then we go back to day 6 and we hear a little bit more, not necessarily day 6, we go back to Adam and what he's like and how God had formed him. A little more detail about it. So some people would say, oh, it's like messed up, the orders. No, it isn't. It was done like this on purpose. Everything was very good, it says at the end of chapter 131. That's why we know it. And the creation was finished of Adam. In chapter 1, also, if you look at verse 28, if you just turn over there, I'm going to just take a quick look at it. Chapter 1, verse 28, it says, and God blessed them. So a lot of people say, well, Adam's the one who named all the animals and did all of that. No, most likely Eve was there with him to help him along. You know, was she not taking notes? Because the guy's handwriting is horrible. I'm just joking. But you know what I'm talking about. I can just see they're working together. Adam's thinking about, they're discussing what the names of these, you know, that they did that, by the way, in one day. I'm not exactly sure how that could have happened, but that's what the scripture tells us. And so Adam and Eve are working together, we know in verse 28, because it says them. Some would say there is a contradiction, but no, it is a flashback, as I said before. God did not, he wanted to make a concise discussion of the creation in chapter 1. So chapter 2 flashes back to when Adam was created. It's kind of like the four Gospels. He wants different perspectives at different times. All of the Gospels are written at different times. They're written about the same exact thing that happens. But it's four different perspectives, and I think that's kind of the way Genesis is. Number one, the first point I want to make here is Adam's perfection. Adam's perfection. He wasn't like us in every single way. One of the ways is he was sinless. He was sinless. We are not. The sin had not happened. The great fall had not happened yet. So we see in verses 4 through 7, Adam's perfection. In the scripture, as you read it, it says, these are the generations of the heavens and earth were created when no bush was a field. And in verse 6 and 7, and a mist was going up for the land and was watering the whole face of the ground. But this is all about Adam's perfection. And another thing to consider is a little bit different too. There was no rain. There was that mist. Maybe that made it better for some of the people during that. Well, maybe it made it better for Adam and Eve at that time. But that's what it is. It's this mist. It's really interesting. There's been some scientific discussion about this canopy that would have ended with the flood. But that was all the water and moisture they needed. And we don't know all the details about that. One day we'll know from the Lord how this all happened. But that's the way it was here at the beginning of Adam. Speaks to the canopy that was over the earth during this time. Adam was never an animal, okay? Adam was never an animal. Humans are not animals. Evolutionists would say, yeah, we're just evolved apes. And that's not what the Bible pictures for us. And Let me get this straight. I was talking with Chris the other day. He came up to me and said, look, I don't have a problem with people that have the teach the fundamentals but believe differently about creation. I'm like that too. So there are some people that believe in evolution, but they believe in Jesus too. Okay? I think there's some things that kind of take away from the foundational principles of God's word. When you bring evolution, when I say evolution, I'm talking about adaptation between species. I'm talking about evolution from one species to another, which is what some people believe. And again, I'm not going to condemn them here today. I want to say that to the public. I don't condemn them if they believe in Jesus and believe that Jesus is a sacrifice and Jesus died and, you know the gospel, okay? So I would fellowship with even people that might not agree with me. So some account for evolution by saying Adam was an animal before God breathed into him the concept of the soul. Now, if I had a King James Bible, which I'm going to grab one, I have one right here. I'd like to have that right here. If you open up Genesis chapter 2, verse 7, check it out because it's different. 2, verse 7. Right at the beginning, Evans. Come on, here we go. Chapter 2, verse 7, this is what it says. I'm going to read it for you, and then I'll read from the ESV. It says, and the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. And man became a living soul. Okay, if you look at the ESV, which I have here, I'm going to read that last phrase from you. Then man became a living creature or being. You say, well, not a big deal. Yeah, it is. Here's why. Because one of the evolutionary theories is that evolution was happening. And once you got to the most evolved ape, then that's when God breathed in the soul of man. In verse 7. Does that make sense? But if you look at that verse, soul is not really the right rendering. In fact, the two words involved there in the Hebrew is nafesh kaya. Nafesh kaya is the Hebrew there. And that's breathing in, that's at the beginning. Breathing in life at the beginning is really what the Hebrew rendering is. Anyway, so I say that, of course, on the backs of Hebrew scholars. that's how I'm gonna say that on the backs of John C. Whitcomb, who's one of my heroes in the faith, Hebrew scholar, and this is some stuff that I was able to read about, but I've heard it from many others as well. So it's his life began right here is what I'm talking about. Where the Christian evolutionary theories is that evolution is taking place all the way up until that evolved ape, and then God breathes in the soul. Which, if you're going to be an evolutionist, that's not so bad because it brings God into the picture. So I want to give them some kudos for that. That they're not leaving God out of the creation, ever. The long day evolutionists or whatever, the Christian evolutionists, they can't leave God out of it or it's not Christian evolution. Okay. Anyway, I don't agree with that, by the way. I don't think that's the best view. I'm for this. This is God's giving life to Adam and he's the first man. So, moving on. We were not formed from apes. He became a man. The dust, that's the animal kingdom. But that we come from dust, but we are breathed life in from God, this life, this being a human, okay? With the reasoning and the soul. Yeah, the soul is there, but that soul came at creation. Adam was different too. He was absolutely sinless when he was formed, perfect when he was created as a man. I mean, there was potential for sin. He had the option to sin, which he later did. But at those beginning days, he was perfect. Let me make sure I'm getting all this here. Oh, yeah, we got the no to that. And Adam became a living being when he was created. And again, what has been taught is the living soul. I wish I would be better about using these slides. Verse 7 is used by the sum to make account for evolution.
And I went over that already. The Lord God formed from an ape and he became man. Dust means animal. This can't be because we return to dust. He created them male and female. He just doesn't breathe in them as apes. He was absolutely sinless and perfect when he was created. Man was a brilliant. He was a great thinker. Think of all of those animals that were named. Unbelievable. Adam named those animals. We see that from verse 19. But was he perfect and omniscient like God? No, he was a man. He wasn't all-knowing. But he was pretty good. Jesus is omniscient. How was he on the earth? Philippians 2 tells us that he made himself of no reputation. So Jesus was an omniscient man. He had some limitations as a man, but he was all-knowing. Luke told us he had to grow in wisdom and knowledge. He knew less than Adam. Okay, so if you're comparing Adam and Jesus, I mean, he had to grow into that. When he was a child, he thought like a child, and he had to grow into that. But he was still perfect through all of that. Adam had some really good qualities, near perfect as a man. Adam started off as not all the birds and mammals, less than 20,000 he named in one day. But that's the point. Adam was not like us because the sinful nature was not there at that point. Adam was totally sinless. He had a perfect sinless mind up until this point. He saw perfectly what they were instantly. Where was Adam? Because that's the next part of the scripture. Verses 8 through 14, let me read that. I'm just going to read it through. If you can follow along, it'd be great. Verse 8 through 14, And the Lord God planted a garden in the east, and where he put the man whom he had formed, and out of the ground the Lord made to spring up every tree that is pleasant and to the sight and good for food. The tree of life was in the midst of the garden, and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. A river flowed out of Eden to water the garden, and there it divided and became four rivers. The name of the first is the Pishon. It is the one that flowed around the whole land of Havilah, and where there is gold. And the gold of that land was good. Bdellium and onyx stone are there. The name of the second river is the Gihon. It is the one that flowed around the whole land of Cush. And the name of the third river is the Tigris, which flows east of Syria. And the fourth river is the Euphrates. This is a real place. In world history, you would have learned it as the Fertile Crescent, the end of the Fertile Crescent, at the bottom of the Fertile Crescent. You know, the crescent goes like this, okay? And at the bottom of the crescent is where the Garden of Eden is. Do we know exactly where it is? No. But we do know it's in modern-day Turkey because of the Tigris and the Euphrates rivers, which we know, and those are the same rivers the Bible is speaking about. For all, you know, I mean, it's possible that somehow we lost in translation and in passing down all these things, but let's face it. This is where it is, okay? The Gihon, where was that? We're not sure. The other two rivers, we're not totally sure about, but we do know the Euphrates and the Tigris. So this is where it was most likely to be. Can we find a place as a garden? You know, there's people that have gone to Turkey and said, oh, this is where the Garden of Eden is. But I don't think, they don't know for sure. That's where it was. It's a real place. The reason I point this out is because I want you to realize that Genesis is not this bunch of myths. There are some people that want to teach it that way. One of my favorite scholars is teaching this kind of thing. It's like these are myths and they only are representative and they're not really literal. But I believe these things that are said here, this really happened. There's really a place, the Garden of Eden. And there really was a mist over the earth that gave the moisture that was needed. This is from the scripture, and we need to take it like that. Adam's place. Adam's loneliness. Jump to verse 20, 24, and then we'll come back to the verses before that. So Adam's loneliness in verse 20. Let me read 20 through 24 again. The man gave names to all the livestock, and then verse 21, so the Lord caused a deep sleep to fall up, livestock and to the birds of the heavens, to every beast of the field, but for Adam there was not found a helper fit for him. He was lonely, wasn't he? Adam was frustrated with his day's work. Why? When he came home, God wanted him to be frustrated with his experience of the work and monotony of the whole world. He wanted him to be frustrated with that. The gorilla comes home. That doesn't do a whole lot for him. Adam is very frustrated, overwhelmingly alone. And then God heard his sadness, I believe, and provided for him a wife. Eve came from Adam's rib, we read. Verse 20, the rest of the verse is 21. A deep sleep came upon him, and while he slept, took one of his ribs and closed up its place with flesh, and the rib that the Lord God had taken from the man, he made into a woman and brought her to the man. Eve came from Adam's rib. It was the first surgery. You ever think about that? First surgery by God on Adam. It's crazy. It was the first anesthesia because he was put to sleep. Verse 21. Sleep that he cannot awaken. Only God can waken him from it. So it was an anesthesia to knock him out so he wouldn't be in pain. You get the feeling that's really what it was for there. Kind of like when Paul slept and David took a spear. He didn't wake up. Took a spear, kept him asleep. God was in control of that. Adam was in a deep sleep. He just removed the body part. We still have the same. By the way, we still have the same amount of ribs. It's not like, oh, well, men have less ribs than women because they took that one out. No, it's not. We still have the same amount. But women came from that rib of Adam. That's where Eve came. He suddenly created a full-grown woman. Amazing. Adam and Eve become one flesh in the marriage, the first marriage we hear about right here. By the way, the New Testament quotes this in Matthew. What is given to us from the scripture, verse 23. Let's read that again, back to verse 23. Look what it says. The man said, "This at last is bone of my bones, flesh of my flesh, and she shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man." There's a man and a woman here, and that's all that's said about marriage in the Scripture. There's no other marriage in Scripture but a man and a woman. There's nothing else. The world can tell us a million things, but there's nothing else. If you want to be biblical, it may not be how you feel, it may not be how people feel about it, but if you're going to be biblical, a marriage is between a man and a woman. It's clear here. There's nothing else here. "Therefore, a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. And the man and his wife were both naked and were not ashamed." This is what a marriage is all about. At last, she was taken out of man. Finally, he found someone. Moses says this. Why couldn't Adam say this? Because he didn't have a mother and father. Leave and cleave. Leave and cleave. First order of the family. Leave and cleave. Leave your family and you go and you're one with your spouse. That's the biblical model that's here in the scripture. And you know, like, all of us have different experiences, but, you know, Sarah and I have tried our best in our lives to take these to heart. And when you leave and cleave, and we left our parents, and we still loved our parents, and we still spent time with our families. But now we have created a new family. Just, by the way, family's a husband and wife. You don't have to have children to have a family. And some people sometimes don't, they get it wrong. I mean, I think that's part of the purpose of a family, and you want to have children. I'm saying nothing against that. But, you know, sometimes we kind of look down, oh, you don't have children, so you're not a, yeah, you are, you know. If you're married and you've gone God's way, you're together and you're a family. You're still a part of your other families. It's a different way, though. That's not your priority place of concern. That's from the scripture, and it started with Adam and Eve. The ultimate father, the first husband, and then the first father of children. Adam's limits, though. Verses 15 through 17, we read about Adam's limits. And I think in the back of your bulletin, I changed it. I was trying to go with alliteration. Let me find it for you. So I changed a couple of them. Adam's place. Adam's perfection. Adam's predicament was loneliness. Adam's prohibition, verses 15 through 17. Let's look at the scripture for those. Look what it says. The Lord took the man and put him in the garden to work it and to keep it. And the Lord commanded the man, saying, you must surely eat of every tree of the garden, but the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in that day that you eat it, you shall surely die. Adam was limited. He would die only if he ate the tree of good and evil. And he didn't die physically. It was a spiritual death that would happen to him. And it was to challenge his obedience. A lot of people say, well, why did God do that? Why did he even give that? There was that free will that I think we see here. In the heart of Adam, he had the chance. He had to make that decision of obedience, which he didn't. If he ate of the tree of good and evil, he would die. Adam didn't know anything about death up until that time. If he didn't obey, he would wreck the world. And all of the world, all of mankind would inherit that sin. We know that from Romans. And the next chapter. So those are the things. This is the ultimate father. Adam's perfection, his place, his predicament, loneliness, and his prohibition was to stay away from that tree, which we will read it, we will talk about next week, the fall of man, the fall of Adam, and how sin comes into the world. So in conclusion, how did man, in general, when I say mankind, how did mankind get here? By man and a woman. We know that from their children, which we'll read about later on. Cain and Abel came about the way we know that children are born. By neither man or woman. Adam. Created out of nothing. Adam's the only one like that. Not even Jesus, by the way, right? Not even Jesus. Next. By man only. Who is that? Eve came out of man. It's kind of interesting to look at this. And I think the conclusion that comes from looking at this, because there's one more, right? By woman only, who would that be? Who? The only person that came, no. Who's the only person that came out of woman only in the history of the world? Who's the only virgin born one? Jesus, yeah. Now that's not in this passage, but when you're talking about how mankind comes about, most of us know that first one. But that challenged someone's thinking, say, you know what, that's not the only way. That's not the only way that a life came about. And I think what that challenges us is this is God. Like I was saying earlier in the worship time, it is God, the great God of the universe, the creator of the universe. And he created in different ways, and he can do it any way he wanted. He's the great God of the universe with all wisdom, omniscient, all-knowing. And people like to glorify Mary. We should, to some extent. We should, like, reverence her. I don't know. Reverence is not a good word. We should honor her and remember her like we remember the great heroes of the Bible, because she is. She is a heroine of the Bible. She's amazing. And she was chosen by God because of her righteousness. Maybe she was the most righteous woman in the Bible. Maybe. I don't think that's not a good thing to put on anybody. I'm sure she would say, don't give me that one, please. But she was the one chosen to be the only person in the world to bring creation. And creation, and you know, he's always created, so that would be another debate. But to bring Jesus into the world, to be born into this world. No help from man, by the way. And then Adam, the first one, the ultimate father. And then Eve out of Adam. And then they would come together. And you know, we celebrate the creation. We celebrate
the creation of man, every time we see a couple that stands before the altar and says, I'm committing myself to you for life. And we celebrate the creation of man when we enter into that covenant relationship with our spouse. That's kind of interesting to us think about too. As we think about on Father's Day, the creation and the ultimate Father. Adam's role here in the creation. Let's bow for prayer. Heavenly Father, we are so thankful for your word today. It's a challenge to our hearts as we read about who you are, because you are the great God of the universe, the creator. And you have put together an amazing plan. You put together an amazing plan of how mankind would come about. And every detail perfectly planned in your omniscient, on your all-knowing ways. And we give praise because of that. Lord, ultimately you show the greatest love of all because you did bring, as we mentioned, the only person born of only a woman, Jesus. He came into this world. You came into this world as we speak of you as the deity and the Trinity. You came into this world and you came in to do something about the sin because of the fall, because of the sinful condition that Adam inherited for the rest of mankind. And you sent your son Jesus to be that person that would take on all the sins of the world for those who call upon the name of Jesus. And we're thankful for that. And as we read about the creation, we can see the foundation, the beginnings, and the perfect plan that would be come about as a result of all the things that happen here in Genesis. We give you praise and glory because of who you are. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. You are dismissed.